What you see here is an Apple studio display, and this one, like many or even most that were produced, had a serious defect. You'd be using your computer and all of a sudden, thanks Apple. The consensus is that the flyback transformer in the monitor is failing. Well, what is a flyback transformer anyways? A CRT shoots electrons towards the screen. To push the beam to the right place, there is a deflection yoke containing coils that, when given high voltage, generate a magnetic field that deflects the electrons side to side and up and down. The flyback transformer in the CRT produces that high voltage, outputting tens of thousands of volts, and it can also transform a sawtooth signal. Once the electron beam goes from the left side all the way right, it flies back to the left to draw the next line. It also provides high voltage needed for the anode to pull electrons towards the screen, as well as other things. So this part is really critical to how the monitor works, but every flyback transformer is unique to that CRT's design. Miraculously, there's a Spanish company that makes flyback replacements for all sorts of CRTs, including this exact Apple Studio display, which is perfect because getting an original part might be pointless if it's going to fail the same way. I was able to buy this replacement from a domestic reseller, and here it is, a brand spanking new flyback transformer. I also found the technical diagram of how it all connects, as well as the service manual that has instructions for taking the monitor apart. In theory, this should be a straightforward part replacement. In reality, it was a bit of an adventure. By the way, if you listed the kinds of people you should listen to for advice on this, I'd be pretty far down the list, and that probably means you shouldn't rely on my advice for safety reasons. If you do this, you do it at your own risk. Opening it up is pretty easy with the service instructions. I'm gonna fast forward through a lot of this. It mainly involves pulling apart some plastics and a lot of screws. There is one particular step that basically every CRT video out there includes, which is discharging the anode. Remember that the anode maintains a high voltage to pull electrons? All that high voltage will shock the crap out of you if you touch it when it's charged. To discharge it, you can use a special discharge tool or ground a screwdriver to the case and very carefully poke under the rubber cap and touch the metal inside. This CRT is supposed to discharge itself automatically after I turn it off, and it's been unplugged for a month already, but it's easy to do the discharge step, so please, do it every time you work on a CRT. Okay, more disassembly work, but at some point the instructions just end and I still haven't gotten the board out completely. It's attached to some kind of plastic frame that's stuck into a metal frame and I just cannot figure out how to properly get the board out. When I tried to bend the plastic clips, they just snapped off, so I guess I solved that problem. Now that I finally had the board out, I finished attaching the neck board and oh no, I need to actually desolder the flyback. I mean, I knew I'd have to do this, but a little secret here. I have no idea what I'm doing, but I'm not smart enough to listen to warning signs, so here we are. I'm trying to desolder this piece of junk, and it's not going well. Look, if you desolder a capacitor, that's 2 pins to desolder. This flyback has 15 pins, and it's really hard to remove all the solder from each pin. There might be some teeny tiny little bit of solder still stuck inside a couple of the holes, and the whole thing just doesn't budge, and I have no idea why. After many tries, I finally was able to desolder enough pins and pry off the flyback. So, no turning back now. Before I installed the replacement, the manufacturer said I need to remove a particular capacitor. I didn't think I had the right tool for cutting it, so I just desoldered it too. Then, time to put in the new replacement, and WTF is this? Okay, well, this is what Dremels were invented for. Okay, so that's what it looks like with that corner Dremeled out there. And you can see. There's now just enough space for that spark gap. And there we go. Perfect fit. Just need to solder all the pins in. Conveniently, there are 5 fewer pins on this new flyback compared to the old one. Nice. Now what? Oh yeah, these wires that go into the neck board. The original flyback had white, red, and orange wires, and the makers of the replacement, in their infinite wisdom, put red, white, and black wires. In the included instructions, they do say that O is the color of focus cable that coincides with the original matches the same color cable in the HR. If you said that white goes with white, red goes with red, and black goes with orange, I'd say that makes sense. It's also wrong. Absolutely wrong. And you'll send thousands more volts than you should be sending to the G2 wire. The right answer, apparently, is that white goes with white, black goes with red, and red goes with orange. Why? Because the G2 screen wire is not a focus wire. It's the screen wire. Tricky. And you can tell that the red wire comes out the bottom, where the screen dial is, and the technical diagram also shows this. It's also the only one of the three that doesn't have an extra thick 2-layer insulation because it carries fewer than 1,000 volts. Oh, and here's something idiotic. You see how I spliced these wires from the flyback to the neckboard? Yeah, don't do that if you can. I thought this wire was only 1,500 volts. Apparently it goes up to many thousands of volts. This heat shrink tubing has a dielectric strength of like 600 volts a mil. It's about 10 to 13 mils thick, and yeah, that might not be enough. What I should have done is unplug and remove the old cables completely, and then plug in the new ones. Kids, don't do this at home. High voltage dangers aside, the rest of the process is mostly just doing the disassembly in reverse, with one fun step in between. With the back cover still off, this is the part where we hook up the monitor and turn it on. Hitting the power and no smoke, so that's good. I can hear the staticky noise from the screen. Okay, now we've got a sacrificial computer hooked up. Didn't want to hook up my power Mac in case it gets fried. It looks like crap, but this is actually really, really good because it's bright, it's two-dimensional, and I can see what it's supposed to be. And by adjusting these knobs, I can fix the image. Those diagonal white lines are because the G2 is turned too bright, so that's easy enough to set. The focus is trickier because it's not like one knob controls horizontal and one knob controls vertical focus. I'm not sure how they're related exactly, but it took some trial and error to get the right combination. And look at that, CRT perfection. A bit more final assembly. And there you have it, a complete end-to-end flyback replacement, and I didn't even have too many leftover parts once I reassembled it. Around the world, there are still people who remember how to fix CRTs, and I'm sure you can find a professional who can do this for you if you find and buy the part. Anyways, thanks for watching, and let me know how bad I am at CRT repair in the comments.
21-inch Trinitron with full color calibration. We calibrate these at the factory with a $70,000 colorimeter, and there is magic circuitry inside this thing that monitors everything throughout the life of the display and adjusts it perfectly to keep it in perfect color calibration for the life of the display. It's incredible. It's a publishing dream. It is the most sophisticated display on the market today, $1,499. Second, what will probably be the mainstream display, 17-inch Tron display, phenomenal quality, phenomenal design, $499.